that is loops, decision making statements, then arrays, strings. Now from this lecture we are going to start with another important topic of any programming language, that is functions. So functions are used in C programming language to make our program more optimized and more efficient. So how can we use function, that we are going to study in this chapter. So in this video basically I am going to explain about the function introduction, types of function, basically about the user defined function. Then I am going to talk about how you can define a function and how you can call that function. And last but not the least, at the end of this chapter I am going to post the videos about the practicals of the functions, right? So first we will start with the introduction of function. So let me give you one scenario. So you want to perform a task. So basically if you can see the definition over here, function is nothing but the block of statement to perform some specific task. Suppose you want to add two numbers, or suppose you want to make a calculator, suppose you want to, you know, print something. So functions are nothing but the block of statement that have been written in order to perform some particular task. Now for to understand this concept, let me give you an example. Suppose you want to perform some task repeatedly, right? So you want to add two, you want to ask user for two numbers and add them numbers rigorously. You want to do this task again and again. Now you have two choices for performing this task. Either you write the code, either you repeatedly write the code, or what you can do, as you can see here, the other option is the plan B can be create a function to make your code more optimized. Now one can relate that why ma'am loop is also used for this, right? So we are using loop to optimize our code. But the problem with loops are it will be executing continuously until it will encounter the condition to be false. So sometimes it may happen that you want to add two numbers, then you want to perform some particular task, then again you want to add the number, then you want to perform some particular task. So if you want to do series of this kind of task, at that time you don't want to continuously add two numbers. You want to add numbers at frequent intervals, right? After performing some kind of task. So at that time, what you can do, you can create a function which will add two numbers. So whenever you need to add numbers, you can just call the function and use it. So don't worry if you don't understand. I'm going to explain it with the help of practicals, and then after it will be more, you know, understandable by you. But right now you know that the plan B, that creating a function, is really very good plan, and a good programmer is the one who uses functions in his program. Now there are basically two types of function. First is predefined function and second is user defined function. Now before even understanding the name function, you all know about functions and what it does. How you all have used printf, you all have used scanf, maybe some of you are using getchar and getS, right? So these functions are predefined functions. So what exactly predefined functions are? These functions are defined in the header file, that is the library files like stdio.h, conio.h, string.h that we have already used, math.h, etc. So these functions are defined in this file. So how my computer would know that whenever I am using strlen, it should find the length of the string. You don't know the code, you know just the name. So at that time you were calling the function when you write strlen. So you were calling the function from the header file string.h, right? So similarly in printf, whenever you are writing printf, my computer will understand that I have to print whatever in between that inverted comma on the screen. So how my computer know? My computer knows this because these functions are already defined and the code is already written inside the header file. That's why these functions are called predefined library functions. But user defined functions are like, suppose some users want to perform some customized task like addition, subtraction, multiplication, finding factorial of a number, finding or printing Fibonacci sequence, finding the reverse of a number. So these are the logic for which user predefined functions are not available. So for such task, user can also make their own function, right? So when user is making its own function, user first have to define the function and then have to call function when it needed, right? So how can you define a function and what exactly the user defined function look like? That we are going to see in this video. So stay tuned with me. Now, as you can see, the syntax of user defined function. How user defined functions look like? So you have to remember the syntax. First is the return type, then space, then the function name, then inside the round brackets you have to write the argument list, and inside the curly braces you have to write that block of code that you want to perform repeatedly. Now, if you don't understand this terminologies, then please be patient. I'm going to explain that with the help of example, so don't worry. Now, first word is return type. So what exactly this return type is? Return type can be of a type integer, float, character, short, etc. It can be void also, right? So in short, it will be kind of a data type. Now, what exactly this return type is? Whenever you are writing some function, what kind of output you are expecting from function, right? So suppose I am writing a function to add two numbers, then what kind of output I'm expecting? I'm expecting kind of integer output, because I'm adding two integers, so the result will be integer. So from addition function, I am expecting the integer output. So I can write int over return type, right? Suppose I am dividing some kind of function, at that time I'm expecting kind of float output. So based on that, you can write your return type. So return type can be of any data type such as integer, double, character, void, short, etc. Now then after the function name. The function name is similar to the identifier. In identifier, we have told that any variable name that is used or any function name are called identifier because it is used to identify, right? So suppose I want to distinguish two functions. How can I distinguish them? I can distinguish using its name. So name can be anything. As it is user defined function, user can give any appropriate name to its function, but it is preferable that user give a name according to some specific task. Suppose you want to add two number, you can give a name add, addition, sum, etc. Suppose you want to reverse the number, you can give name say reverse, right? So that some other people who is seeing at your code will be able to understand what kind of function is this. If you are using name ABC in XYZ, no one is going to know without going through the logic that why this function is used. So function name, it can be anything. However, it is advised to have a meaningful name for the function so that it would be easy to understand the purpose of function just by seeing its name. I hope this point is clear to you now. Now, argument list. We have seen the argument list inside that round brackets, right? So, what input you are giving to your function? That is known as the arguments. Now, suppose I want to add two numbers. I have to give function two integer numbers. My function will perform a logic and add two numbers and give me the integer result. So whatever input I'm giving, it is known as argument list, and what kind of output I'm expecting, that is known as return type, right? That we have already covered. Suppose you are using putchar function, right? So inside putchar, we are putting a character. So my putchar predefined function is taking character input, right? So it is already defined inside its definition. Suppose I'm using putS, that is to print string string on screen. At that time, inside the putS, I am putting some kind of string function, string data type, right? Or say character array. So it is defined in this way. Suppose I want to multiply two integers, then my function will expect two integer numbers as its input. So this kind of input are known as arguments. So argument can be of list, because there is no bound over the number of inputs. You can have two arguments, three arguments, say two numbers, three numbers. Based on that, you can decide, right? So argument list contains variable names along with the data type. So if you want to use, say, if you want to add two numbers, you can use int A and int B as two arguments, right? So where entails data type and A and B are identifier of say variable names. These arguments are kind of input for the function. For example, function which is used to add two integers will be having two integers argument. Now, last but not least, the block of code. So inside the curly braces, you have to write the logic. So now, whatever logic you have been written for the finding, addition, subtraction, or reverse of a number, that you have to write inside the function body instead of writing inside main. So now you are not going to write the logic in main. You have to write the logic inside the function body. Even if after this much explanation, if you don't understand the concepts, don't worry. I am going to cover one example based on this. So here I have given one code. So first I have written include, which is mandatory. After that, instead of writing int main, I am writing the function. Now this function is to add two numbers. So for to add two numbers, I need two integers as input, which is argument. So that's why I have written int a and int b. I am going to give these arguments to my function when I'm calling it. Function name is here add. So as it is performing addition, I am giving some appropriate name as add, and I am expecting some kind of integer output from it. So that's why I have written int over here, right? Now return, what exactly this return is? So whenever I am passing say 5 and 3 in add, it will add two numbers and it will give that addition to me, right? So here that block of function is only called the definition of function, right? It should be done before main. So before main, I am telling my computer that this kind of functions you are going to use. So whenever you see add, don't give me an error. It is going to do some structures like this. It is going to perform this task, right? So I have told you that if you are not including header file when you are using printf, you will find an error. So we have to first include header file, and then this is a similar concept, user defined concept. So before using that function, you have to write that hey computer, we are going to use these functions, right? So this is called function definition. So function name is add with integer arguments a and b. Now return type int, because we are expecting int kind of result from the functions. We are expecting this kind of function. Now the function definition is over. Now we are regularly writing int main. Inside int main, I am going to ask user that enter two numbers. So user is going to ask two numbers. So I am declaring two variables, num1 and num2, which is going to hold the value which is entered by user. So say first, initially num1 and num2 is having garbage value, but then after when user entered the value using scanf, it will have some specific value, say 10 and 8. Right? So suppose num1 is 10 and num2 is 8. Now what I am going to do, inside printf, I am writing that the addition of this two number is percentage %d. But instead of writing just the variable name, I am directly writing add num1 and num2. So what exactly is being done here? Num1 is carrying value 10 and num2 is carrying value 8. So add 10 and 8 is passed to my function. Now a become 10, b become 8. So it will return value 10 plus 8, which is 18. So inside this printf, what exactly is being printed? Addition is 18. I hope you guys understand what exactly the phenomena is. If you don't understand, just repeat this 5 minutes of video and watch it again if you don't understand, right? Try to understand this code. If you don't understand, then also try to perform this code with various steps of logics and lines, programming lines, right? So here we have to use int addition or int add, int num1 and num2. So this kind of function is being used to call the function, right? So I want to call the function. So here num1 and num2 is having integer type. As you can see here, num1 and num2 is defined as integer. Similarly, function is also having int a and int b. So this both match should match. It is not possible that I am writing in definition float a and float b, and inside the calling of function, that is inside main, I am writing int num1 and num2, right? So both of this function definition arguments and the calling arguments must match. So which is known as function prototype. So I am telling user that at the definition that function is taking only integer arguments. So inside void main or int main also you have to write integer numbers only or integer variables only. So here you can see I have written one alternative code. So here I have taken int a and int b inside my function definition. But instead of directly written a plus b, I am taking one variable int sum and sum equal to a plus b. So whatever value of a and b are there inside the function calling, it will be add them and put into the new variable named as sum. And at the last, it will return the value of sum to me. So here inside main, void main, I can declare just num1 and num2 as integer only because in function definition, is function definition I have taken integer arguments that a and b. So here they have taken num1 and num2 as integer. Then I'm going to take two values from user. So num1 and num2 is having now some kind of value which is entered by user. Then I'm calling the function as, then I'm taking one another variable result or say re as res. So what is the value inside, what should be the value inside this res? It should be equal to calling of function addition num1 and num2. So here I am calling addition num1 and num2. So what will be called addition, whatever two values entered by user, that is 10 and 8. So now after it is copied, it will go again to the definition of addition where num1's value is copied to a, that is 10. So now a becomes 10 and num2's value is copied to b, that is now b becomes 8. Now what as it is, the sum variable is again created, sum equal to a plus b, that is 10 plus 8, so sum become 80. Now it will return this value to function. Now what actually this return means, where from where the function is called, the control goes to there. So now the control again goes to this program where addition num1 num2 gives result as 80. So now res equal to 80. So whenever I'm printing the value of res, that is the output is, or output is percentage d, it will print value 80. So this is what about the function. Even you can use void data type to as a return type. Sometimes it may happen that you don't want to, you don't expect any kind of output inside function. Suppose I have created one function print. You can do this by yourself also. You are creating a function named print. You cannot create printf because printf is a keyword. But you can create function print. Here I have created function introduction, my introduction. Inside the function, I am just printing hi. My name is Komal, how are you all? Right? So inside this function, I am doing nothing. I am just printing something. At this time, I don't want any value from the function. I just want to print this on screen. So that's why I can use void. Here you can see, whenever I'm writing void, I'm not returning anything, right? So do you understand this concept? I have been used int main, and that's why I'm telling you guys that use return. You have to do use return because main is also a function. If its data type is int, that means it is going to return some kind of integer. And that's why we are returning return 0 at last. Right? So, this is why we use, return when we write int. And we don't need to use return when we write void main. So, here also I have written a function as void introduction, which is printing something. So, I do not need to return anything. So, that's why I have not written keyword over there, right? So inside void main, I am just calling the function by writing introduction. I don't need to pass any arguments because it is not going to manipulate it. It is just used to be printed. So introduction is being called. So whenever inside main introduction is being called, it will be called to the definition. Inside definition, it is going to print these three lines. And after when the function encounters the last curly braces, the closing brackets, it will just go and so it will just come to the point and it will return 0. So this is how you can perform a program using void as a return type. Now, few points that you need to understand is main in C++ term is also a function. So you cannot use any function name as main because we only have one main inside the program. Each program must have at least one function which is main. So even if you are not using functions, you know that main is also a function. So every C program must have at least one function that is main. This is no limits. You can use any number of functions inside your program. It is just your desire that what kind of functions you want to use. And last but not the least, a function, if the function is calling itself again. So I have made a function introduction, and inside the body of introduction definition I am again calling introduction. That kind of recursion infinite loop is called recursion. We are going to cover a separate chapter about recursion, so don't worry, we are going to perform the practicals as well. So right now just understand that recursion is nothing but the kind of function. Now the main concept is actual parameter and formal parameter. So what exactly this actual parameter? Inside main, you are calling a function. Inside the body of main, you are calling a function addition num1 and num2. So here num1 and num2 are called actual parameters because it is used in calling function. And whatever parameters used in the function definition before main, that if we have used a and b, are called formal parameters. So whatever parameters which is being used in the function definition body is known as formal parameter. So here when function is called, so where function is called, it is called inside the main. So the values expressions that are passed in function call are called the parameters or actual parameters. The parameter used in function definition statement which contains data type or its time of declaration is called formal parameter. So this is all about, if I give the example, for example, num1 and num2 are actual parameters and a and b are formal parameters. Now this is the last topic that I am going to talk about in today's video. So basically user-defined function is having four types based on the argument passed and the return type. So if return type, if it is having some kind of return type, then it is, you know, if it is having some kind of return type and I am also going to pass arguments. Say an example, I have used function int add int a int b, which is having two arguments and having return type int. So it is kind of fourth type. Suppose I have used, in previous slides, I have used function introduction. Introduction was having no return type, that is void, and it is not going to use any argument as input. So that is called no argument passed and no return type. That is kind of first type. And second type is in which I am giving return type but not giving any arguments. And third type is I am not giving any arguments but I am giving I am not giving any return type but I am having arguments, right? So based on this we have divided functions in four parts. Now these four types I am going to cover in next video in detail with the help of example. So in next video, I'm going to show you that how exactly you can define a function, declare a function and call the function, what are the actual parameters and formal parameters practically, and then after I'm going to talk about these four types using appropriate examples. So stay tuned with me, this is a very important topic. I hope you enjoyed this class. If you have any doubt, you can comment below the comment section. Thank you so much.